Welcome to the Second is for Everyone podcast. We welcome all people, regardless of race, gender, political party, sexual orientation, or background, to learn about your Second Amendment civil rights and the many facets of firearms ownership. Hey, I've been hearing something lately, and it's been bothering me, and I just want to talk about it, and I'm throwing this in because this is the title of this episode, Civil War. I've been hearing a lot of different podcasts, seeing a lot of stuff on social media about America going into Civil War number two, the Boogaloo, the Big Igloo, and a lot of people are saying it tongue in cheek. And I get it with the differences that we're having, what the media is showing you. I guess if you have no grasp of history of what really happened, you go, okay, yeah, I can see that happening. Please, before you say we're going to have war, if we're going to go to civil war, if Trump gets reelected, we're going to have a civil war, if Biden gets elected, could we stop and actually think about what happens in a civil war? 93, a song came out from Guns N' Roses entitled Civil War. And I'm like, I mean, talks about the lyrics itself. It's like, look at your young men fighting. Look at your women crying. Look at your young men dying. The way they've always done before. Look at the hate we're breeding. Look at the fear we're feeding. Look at the lives we're leading. The way we've always done before. My hands are tied. The billions shift from side to side. And the war goes on with brainwashed pride. For the love of God and our human rights, and all these things are swept aside by bloody hands time can't deny, and are washed away by your genocide, and history hides the lies of our civil war. I'm just saying, there are people profiting off the divisiveness that's happening in America and the divisiveness that the media and social media is pushing between us. You don't hate your neighbors. You really don't, just because you have a different opinion than them. Understand, when the American Civil War happened, people killed their neighbors. They burned their neighbors' homes down. They raped their neighbors' wives. They murdered their neighbors' children. Are we really there yet? Are we really there at all? Forget what you see on the news, because that's not happening in your town, in your city. And usually it's only going on in your state capital at a protest with just a certain group of people that it seems the media flocks around whenever there's a confrontation and sticks cameras in their faces. I'm telling you, we're being played. And we're being played by people with an agenda. It may not even be the same agenda, but it is agenda. I mean, we've all heard, if it bleeds, it leads, on your nightly news. These confrontations that some were paid for, and now people have gotten caught up in it, and they can't stop this snowball that they've created. They've just had another shooting at a rally. Most people don't know the whole story, so there's no reason for me to get into that particular incident until we have more information. They're saying it's Antifa. Maybe it's not. I have no idea. We aren't heading for civil war unless we allow it to happen. The radical squeaky wheels get the media coverage, and they get the grease. It's time for a lot of us that are more central in our thinking, that understand you can have a different political opinion, you can have a different lifestyle, you can have a different sexuality, you can have a different anything. We do not have to be alike, but even if I don't participate in your lifestyle, whatever it may be, does not mean I hate you. Doesn't mean I dislike your lifestyle. It's just not something I do. If I'm not the same religion as you are, does that mean I hate you? Well, if you pay attention to social media and believe everything they're trying to serve you on a silver platter, yeah. And that's just ridiculous. Don't fall for the okey-doke. Don't believe this entire country's falling apart based on a difference of opinion. This country didn't fall apart. This country didn't fall apart during the civil rights struggle. This country didn't fall apart when we were going toe-to-toe with communists and communism and socialism during the Great Depression. It didn't fall apart then and is not going to fall apart now. We are, as individuals, in a much better place financially than we were during the Great Depression. We have a lot more people working even now, post-COVID. It's not even post-COVID. We're still in the middle of it in some states. I live in New Jersey, so we haven't opened up all businesses 100%. But people aren't starving. There aren't lines at soup kitchens. There's no, hey, brother, can you spare a dime thing. We're nowhere near some of the lowest points we had in the 20th century. But the news insists that we're going into a civil war. That's ridiculous. Historically, that's ridiculous. So I guess the point of this whole thing is to say this civil war boogaloo crap is bullcrap. People are marketing it. People are making money off of it. But it's far from the truth. But if you keep repeating something, you'll make it come true. So here's my question. Where are the lines going to be drawn? Is every city, is every town just going to have uprisings? Are neighbors going to shoot neighbors and burn houses down based on absolutely nothing? I don't think so. There are no states ready to secede from the Union. There is no great slavery issue. The parallels just aren't there. Not really. Not for the Civil War, just as opposed to any other policy that we've had. The Vietnam War. It was divisive at the end. On a national level, there were protests at college campuses and stuff like that. There weren't protests in every town. And we didn't have a civil war during that time period. We didn't have a civil war during a time period where there were a lot of militias in this country. Some were hate-based. The Klan had their little militias running around with SKSs and old school 782 gear and woodland camouflage and stuff like that. And we understood that that was a very small minority of people. Now I'm supposed to act as if there's a battalion of Antifa in my little 1 square mile town? It's ridiculous. Hey, man, I'm just putting it out there. We're adults. We have to have the ability to critically think, not just repeat things you hear. Please be responsible with the information you pass along, because you can hope and wish yourself into a bad situation. And that's all I'm seeing. Hopefully, more level heads will take over and just stop pushing this silliness and understand it will be to the detriment of not only this country, but many others if America goes into a civil war. I just wanted to say that. Listen to this song on your own, because I'm not going to play it here because of licensing and everything else. And just listen to the words and understand the devastation that it caused. Maybe even just Google it on Wikipedia and read about the death and devastation. It took over a century for the South to even recover from jobs and manufacturing and everything else from the Civil War. Do you think COVID did something to the economy of America? What do you think a Civil War would do? All right, that's it. That's the end of this. Let's go ahead and get into the show and talk about some other things. I'll be right back. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Second Is for Everyone podcast, your favorite weekly podcast that comes out once a month, whether you like it or not. I'm Tony Simon. This is 2A4E Podcast, episode 76, Civil War. Hey, what's going on? Let's talk about what has been happening. We've actually had our first two Second Is for Everyone diversity shoots in Pennsylvania since the last time I spoke to you guys on this podcast, and they were great. The Heritage Guild in Easton, PA has been hosting our events since the governor of New Jersey decided to keep the 25% capacity limitation on indoor ranges in New Jersey. Thereby, I cannot host my events because there would be too many people coming to my events for the range to allow indoors. So the Heritage Guild stepped up, and we've been hosting events there. We hosted one in August, another one in September, and we have one coming up October 22nd. It's going to be a lot of fun. It was great. The very first one was awesome. I had some friends I haven't seen in a while. My friend Les Schaefer, who supported diversity shoot since 2015, I think, actually finally showed up in person at one after supporting it for 5 years. That was awesome. And he brought his lovely wife with him. Sig actually sent Jim, one of their company reps, down. So Sig Sawyer was actually represented at the event. They ran a booth. They helped out. Jim was awesome. He introduced people to the P365 and the M17. And then he also brought out the tread rifle. So people shot a lot of Sig guns, which I thought that was really cool, especially because Sig came through not only with firearms, but with Sig ammo. And Sig optics were on their guns. And it was pretty cool. I got a video of me shooting the M17, which I have not actually fired any P320 until that time, I think. And I definitely hadn't fired the M17, which is the military version of the SIG P320. What else happened? Oh, Sarah Joy Albrecht from Hold My Guns, which is a firearm storage solution for firearms owners that are going through some kind of mental health emergency. She came out and talked about her organization and what they do, holdmyguns.org. They work with FFLs in your area. So if you're going through something, if you're going through a divorce and you want to get your firearms out of the house, you can work through Hold My Guns. And this is countrywide. She's trying to work with different FFLs throughout the country that will allow you to take your guns there and transfer them to the FFL. So they're in the FFL's possession and they're out of your control. If you're going through some rough times, if you're in the military and you're transferring or something and you don't have anywhere to secure your firearms, this gives you an option that you didn't have before, especially in states like New Jersey, where I can't just legally go, hey, come get my firearms because I'm going through some stuff right now and I'd rather them not be in my home. Not legal to be able to do that here. And Sarah's trying to set it up so it's illegal to be done in other places with Hold My Guns. So that's who came to our event, spoke. Oh, and CNJFO has been just a supporter of ours, the Coalition of New Jersey Firearms Owners, that sometimes I forget to mention them because they feel like they're just a continuous part of the diversity shoot. But Nick And the other guys have always come out to our event, made time for us, and I can't stress enough how awesome that is to have friends like that. CNJFO is working in New Jersey to bring people into the firearms community all the time, but they're also fighting for our rights to actually carry concealed in our state, in New Jersey, because they have something called justifiable need here, which you have to ask the government not only for permission, but you have to give them a reason and they have to deem that reason good enough for you to be able to carry, and they deny everyone. New Jersey has less than 1,500 concealed carry holders in the state that aren't carrying concealed as part of their jobs. It's a state with, 9 million people, 1 million gun owners. and 1,500 people that can carry legally concealed. It's ridiculous, but that's what we dealt with. But that was our very first diversity shoot in Pennsylvania, and it was great. The Heritage Guild came through. We had gifts. We had prizes for our raffle tickets that were sold, and people walked out with some really cool prizes. And then we had the second event. That was in September. Even more people came. CNJFO, Nick Wong was there again speaking about what they did. Sarah from Hold My Gun showed up again. Matt came from the Heritage Guild and actually gave an awesome safety brief. I just wanted one of their officers to come in. I mean, not officers, but range safety officers come in and maybe give a quick safety brief to everyone before we kick the event off. Because, of course, you know me, I had to order pizzas. I had to get that right. I had to do some other stuff. So I figured if someone else could do the safety brief, just the four rules of firearm safety, it would be cool. Well, Matt came in and pretty much took over hosting the show for about 10 minutes, but it was awesome because people felt really comfortable, gave out his business card and told people to call him on his cell phone if they needed any help, because the Heritage Guild is there to help people, welcome people into the firearms community and give you the best options that you can get. And I thought that was pretty cool. Anthony Colangelo did the same thing, would come in and welcome people directly to the range. And, you know, just if you need anything, let me know. I've been blessed to have a bunch of awesome rangers work with us to introduce new people, regardless of race, gender, economical conditions, sexual orientation, anything, into the firearms community. And really, these owners and these places blow up the stereotype of what a range looks like and what the people who own ranges care about. So I think that's really awesome. And I just think it's amazing. So that's what's been happening. We also, I've contacted Cole Steele Knives. They've actually donated some knives that we're going to be giving away at the October 22nd event as part of our prize bags. And Kershaw also donated some knives that we're going to be giving away as part of our prize bags. So that's pretty cool, because sometimes we forget that knives are covered under the Second Amendment also. And I'd contacted these companies, and because of the work I've done over the time, actually we've done, but people see me and hear about me mostly with the Second Is for Everyone, that they were like, yes, we'll gladly support you. So that's pretty cool. And guys are going to get some quality EDC knives out of these events because of support from knife companies that actually support your Second Amendment rights and grassroots organizations like 2A4E. So that's pretty cool, because I always do that pocket check, that EDC pocket check of people that come in and ask, hey, do you carry a knife? And a lot of gun guys do, which is cool. You should also carry a flashlight, too. And Streamlight has worked with us for a while. I have to contact them and see if they can help us out again. Because if you can come into my event as a first time, whatever, and get some cool EDC, some t-shirts, cool hat, I think our prize bags, I try to keep between like $80 and $100. And yay, come out, get some. What else? Man, did a lot because I've waited so long between doing podcasts. Let me see. So we did the diversity shoots 1 and 2. We've got the third one coming up. We got some cool giveaway prizes. That's what we done. Oh, and I was lucky, blessed, thrilled, honored, and humbled to actually speak at the Gun Rights Policy Conference. That happened about 2 weeks ago. I was actually able to speak. I was one of over 100 speakers that talked about the Second Amendment, our Second Amendment rights, and how we fight for them and how we can do a better job fighting for them. And I got to actually go on for about 12 minutes, which went really fast. And I didn't even mean for it to be that long, but I'd written notes down and I just went by my notes. So some people on the event, they read their speech or had rehearsed the speech. I just went by notes and just talked like I do on this show. So please check it out. It's on YouTube. I think it's Second Amendment Foundation Second Amendment Foundation is actually the name of their YouTube channel, and you can watch the whole event for free, or you can go to Second Amendment Foundation's website and take the time there to register so you can get emails about what's happening nationwide, and you can also watch from there. They also had a live link going on Facebook at the same time as it was running on YouTube, but again, the video is available to watch a lot of people, and I think they broke it down into four different segments over the two-day period. It's really worth watching a lot of these people because they are the two-way heavy lifters, the people that are getting it done across the nation. From the lawsuits, they had teams of lawyers talking about the different lawsuits they have that went all the way up to the Supreme Court. I was in awe because you're listening to the people that actually did the groundwork, the suing, the taking states to court. I thought that was awesome. Then you get to see Second Amendment groups from around the country, Connecticut, Florida, California. They even had people in England and Australia come on and talk about what's happening in their countries. They had someone from France that are fighting for their right to keep and bear arms there. I think it's important to understand, and this does not have anything to do with them, America is the last holdout of citizens being able to own and use firearms for self-defense on the planet. If it goes away from here, other countries will use that and take it away from their citizens. Do not think we're on our own here. We're holding the line for a lot of other citizens around the world, even in their country. And we're holding the line for future generations, people that haven't even been born yet. You have no idea what can happen. People somehow assume we can go forward and history doesn't repeat itself, but it obviously does. And if it does, that means the government will crack down on someone based on skin color, religion, political belief, something, and violate their civil liberties just like they've done through our entire past. So that's another reason we should really, really fight for our civil right to keep and bear arms. Even if you're not using it right now, you never know what the future holds. As a lot of people have learned in 2020, a lot of people who listen to this show, a lot of you guys are firearms owners already. And if you are, and if you're a firearms owner in your circle, how many times have you heard people that told you were nuts, tell you you're paranoid, and looked at you like you were wrong, coming to you in 2020 asking how to purchase a gun and asking a whole bunch of questions? Why? Because they didn't think this could happen. And then all of a sudden it is. And they're paying crazy amounts of money for firearms that were half or a third that price in January of 2020. And now they're looking at you talking about, where can I find 9mm ammo or any ammo at that? It's like, no, we told you about this and now you have to live with this craziness. So anyway, I think that's what's been happening. Oh, coming up, we have another Second Amendment rally coming up on October 24th. This is a repeat of last year's rally, which took place in Washington, D.C. Well, Washington, D.C., where you can have a rally against the government is okay. But if you have a pro-2A rally, they want to limit us to 50 people. So pretty much we could not do the rally live in D.C. like we did last year this time. So we're doing it virtually. So you can go to 2A Rally, SecondAmendmentRally.com, I think, and register. And you can also check out 2A Rally on their IG page, and it will have links. And there are going to be 30 of us speaking. I'm one of them. I just got confirmed as a speaker, and I will be speaking at the 2A Rally along with Maj Touré, Kevin Dixie, Cheryl Todd. It's 30 people. I'm not going to name all 30 of them, but check it out. these are heavy lifters. These are people that actually get work done on a daily basis to fight for the Second Amendment rights of all Americans. And I'm really, really happy to be in that lineup. And I think it's amazing. And really, you should check it out. Again, it's Saturday, October 24th, and it's going to be online for free. So I'm going to come back. We're going to talk about a little legislation. We're going to talk about, actually, we probably talk about very little legislation, but what's going on with the courts. See you in a few minutes. Bye. Our friends and sponsor, Matador Arms, is back in 2020 with new versions of their Mag-X. The Mag-X is an insert that allows you to use pistol magazines in your mil-spec AR-15 lower. The Mag-X is now available in models that work with the Glock, SIG P320, Smith & Wesson M&P, CZ75, and P09 and P10 magazines from CZ. You go on their website and you choose the Mag-X that corresponds with your pistol. When you get it in the mail, you install it in your magwell. That's it. That simple. Now your AR-15 accepts the same magazines as your handgun. I support Matador Arms because they make quality products and they also support us. They've been great friends to us. They're awesome people, and we really need to support those that support us. Visit them at matadorarms.com. And welcome back. We're on to legislation in episode 76, Civil War. And the big thing that happened since the last time I spoke to you was, on a national level, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the Supreme Court Justice, passed away. And one, way too many people were happy about it. I thought that was not cool on some people's pages. I mean, I understand where you're coming from with that. We'll have a chance to put another Supreme Court justice that may be pro-2A, but, you know, some people were a little fiendish with it. Some of the things were funny, but some people were a little fiendish with some of the things they posted. Well, her replacement, or the person the president picked, was Amy Coney Barrett. Sometimes mess up the name when I say it. Amy Coney Barrett, or the ACP, ACB. They have her as the next Supreme Court, proposed Supreme Court justice that Donald Trump had already picked. She'd been on the list since early in his presidency when he made up a list of proposed Supreme Court justices. I was actually hoping she got on instead of Kavanaugh. But they chose Kavanaugh, so whatever. She was with the 7th District, I think that's what it was. And she had a case where she pretty much came out and said nonviolent felons should also have their Second Amendment rights given back to them. And a lot of people construed that as she's 100% pro-gun. I don't know if she is or not. She was a clerk under Supreme Court Justice Scalia, and he was one of the more pro-gun-ish Supreme Court justices. He was one of the people that decided on the Heller case, and one of the things he wrote is the common use clause with firearms being used owned on an individual basis. And the thing she says is, if you're a nonviolent felon, you should be able to get your rights back. And everybody's resting on that. It's just some iffy stuff that nobody's... it really bothers me because it seems that no Supreme Court justice outside of Clarence Thomas is like 100% pro-2A. It's just annoying. It's as if, and Clarence Thomas kind of said this, and I'm paraphrasing mainly because I don't run around with a Rolodex full of what the Supreme Court justices say about 2A. But it's like the redheaded stepchild of your civil rights. Like, everything else is nearly unlimited when they talk about things. And don't go the fire in the movie theater, because you can stand up in an empty... You can stand up in a movie theater with all the lights on and scream fire all you want. And all you're going to get is tossed out because you're an idiot if there's no fire. No one is going to arrest you if there's no call. There's no panic. They'll only arrest you if you refuse to leave. They'll probably call the police and have you charged with trespassing. So just stop that. That's just a bad argument. Anyway, her as a Supreme Court justice might be a good thing. And hopefully it can get passed before the election. And we can at least have a chance, because 10 cases were thrown out. Their Supreme Court refused to even hear. And I think two were from Jersey. I know one was from New York. Like, all the behind the Iron Curtain states are the ones that are running, that are taking these things to court. A lot of people go, well, you should just move. Well, this is where the fight's happening, in behind the Iron Curtain states, in states that aren't free to practice their Second Amendment. We're the ones that are sending those cases up. So it's really important that we have judges on every level that are pro-gun, or at least pro-Constitution. So it's really important, and that's why we continually say, all politics are local. You have to make sure you get judges on the local, state, national level that are pro-2A. That's why it's important to be active. That's why it's important to be politically active as a Second Amendment supporter. Like, you have to get out there. You have to make phone calls. You have to make your presence felt, because it's on a lot of different levels. And it's one of the more important reasons to have a president who is more constitutional minded when it comes to putting judges on. Being an activist judge from the bench. Look, if you look through history, and this is something I saw, the Supreme Court is not cutting edge when it comes to civil rights. They pretty much go with status quo in the country. They have not been known to stand up for civil liberties if that's not where the American public is. I mean, go to the Dred Scott case. They refused to see Dred Scott, who was a slave that bought himself to freedom, as a human being. And according to the Chief Justice, if you see him as a human being, then he gets all the rights of every other American, which is the right to keep and bear arms. So this whole gun control thing, of course, is based in racism. And that's one of the reasons they wouldn't even deem a black man as a human being in a Dred Scott case. That's how ridiculous this is. So it's very important for us to be politically active and pay attention to what's happening. While I was away, while I didn't do a show, what happened in the interim was the Democratic National Convention, where pretty much, I think it's the second or third day of the convention, the Democrats blatantly said that it's their platform is anti-gun. Both Biden and Kamala Harris doubled down on the fact that they're going to ban certain firearms, and how they're going to do it may be different, but it is what it is. We have to pay attention to this. Many people, and I've read the comment sections on a lot of different tweets, on a lot of different posts on social media, talking about how that's just something they're saying. Well, how's this? When a politician talks about taking away your civil right, you should believe them. Especially if it's someone like Kamala Harris that passed and enforced a bunch of California's anti-gun laws. You might want to believe what the woman says, since she has a track record of it. You might want to believe what Biden says, because he's the one that passed the Gun-Free School Zone Act. These people have done and have a portfolio full of anti-gun, anti-civil rights work. And when they tell you they're going to get rid of your rights, you should probably believe them. An example here in New Jersey is Governor Murphy campaign 2 years before the election. He had a website up, and if you go back and listen to my shows, I don't know which one it is because I don't even catalog my shows like that. When he has his website and he says the things he was going to do to make it more difficult for New Jersey residents to actually get access to firearms, including raising fees to a ridiculous level. He was going to implement magazine capacity restrictions, which he did. He attempted in this last budget to raise the fees ridiculously in the state for you to even get permission to ask to own a firearm. He was going to raise those fees. Luckily, that got killed in the budgeting process because that was going to add a whopping $6 million to the state's budget, which, of course, is a drop in the pan. See, an easier way to raise money in New Jersey would be to actually allow us to have carry permits and to just charge a fee for that. No, I'm not for it. I think it should be constitutional carry. But make it easier process and get rid of the justifiable need clause in our law. That would actually get us a lot more money. We have over 1 million gun owners in Jersey. I'm sure a significant portion of those would be willing to pay to have permission from the state to carry a firearm on them. So it's not about the money. It's about control. Gun control is always about controlling the populace. Most of the time, it was those people and the undesirables that you wanted to keep disarmed. But it has become everyone. So keep an eye out. Call your senators if you think it will help. If your senator's pro-gun, call your pro-gun senator and let them know you're watching and you want a pro-2A Supreme Court justice. And tell them you'd like them to vote for Amy Coney Barrett as the next Supreme Court justice. If you live in a state like New Jersey, which both of our senators, Cory Booker and Menendez, Bob Menendez, scumbag extraordinaire, it's useless talking to these dorks. I still get their emails. I still went and I still write them. I still shoot them an email. I still tell them what I want them to do as a voter. And most of the time they sent me a pre-made email talking about how they're fighting for our rights and they're pro-2A, but, and then just give you a whole bunch of restrictions that they already have typed up. But you can always make your voices heard. You always want to go, look, I did what I could to stay on the correct side of history, the right side of history, and make sure that we have our rights to exercise them at all times. I mean, that's just something you do. Well, it's useless. Makes no difference. Do it anyway. All right. That's legislation. I mean, the good news is we may have a pro-2A Supreme Court justice coming soon. All right, guys. You know how much I hate doing legislation because it all really comes down to be politically active. That's always the case. Be politically active if you can, if it won't put your job at risk, because some people... I saw it firsthand when I went on the recall for our state senator. People were afraid to sign the recall paperwork because they felt their jobs would be in jeopardy. And I couldn't deny it because I saw the power that guy was able to flex while we were out collecting signatures. When we showed up, actually the day before we were to show up at the meeting place so we could get our instructions and everyone could hand us out the packet so we can get people to sign, he applied pressure to the venue, and the venue canceled on us with less than 24 hours to go before the meeting. The venue told us we couldn't host there. Excuse me. So what happened? The leadership, including Alexander. Wow. I just brain farted. NJ2AS president Alexander Rubin was able to scramble, and I think with about 12 hours to go, he got us a venue for half a day that we were able to pass out the paperwork, and a few hundred of us went through the area, went through the guy's district and got signatures. But when we came back, we couldn't go back to the venue, so we had to stand underneath the overhang on the convenience store next door and turn in the paperwork we collected all day. We were all standing in the rain, lined up so we could turn in our paperwork. That's how much power this dude was able to flex in his district. But we still got it done. He didn't get recalled, but we still put in the work. You always want to put in the work. All right, we'll be back. I'm going to go into the Mad Minute next. Bye. Welcome back to episode 76, Civil War. This is a Mad Minute. Get the popcorn. Get yourself a nice beverage. Sit back. Because as tradition goes, you know this is going to take more than a minute. All right. I wrote a little bit down and then I threw the script away. Because, anyway, let's go. When do you support your police? And when are you about to boogaloo? A lot of people walk around, drive around, bumper stickers on the vehicle. It says, don't tread on me. My cold dead hands. NRA sticker. And then an I back the blue flag. Or Blue Lives Matter stickers on the vehicle. And I have a question for you. Who do you think is going to do the treading? Who do you think is going to come to your house and take your firearms? It's often interesting to me. The very same people that says back to blue. Who do you think is going to make your hands cold and dead when you violate the law? It's just a question I want to toss out there because everybody has to draw their own line. When do you stop complying with the law and make your stand? Because you're going to have to stand against the police when they pass laws that outlaw the firearm you have. When they pass laws that say you're going to have to sell your firearm back to the government. Yeah, I did the things with my fingers too. The air quotes. When you're going to have to sell your, is mandatory that you sell your guns back to the government. When are you going to stand up? Because after they do the mandatory buyback, then they come for your firearms because it's illegal for you to have them. So, I mean, it's just a question because I'm watching this thing with Breonna Taylor. And it's Breonna Taylor's boyfriend shouldn't have shot at the police. He should have immediately surrendered to the armed people that kicked his door in at midnight. And people want to get into the, well, they knocked. Well, she was named, her boyfriend this. She didn't have to stop. Let's not even go into the minutia because right now, right this second, if somehow you knew everything that happened that night at Breonna Taylor's home, if you knew what she was thinking, if you know what her boyfriend was thinking, if you know what the police were thinking, like you know this as if some divine intervention happened and you knew everything that happened that night, right now, you still couldn't do anything about it. You couldn't change a thing. So my question is on at the 30,000 foot level. Let's just back all the way up from what happened that night into talking about the policies that allow what happened that night to happen. That's what we need to worry about. We get caught up too much in the minutiae of what happened to Breonna Taylor specifically and not the bigger overall picture of what could have happened to anyone when government authorities have permission to kick your door in. There you go. You've given them permission to blast your door in because you might have done something illegal. Legality can change. Trust me, as someone that lives in New Jersey, legalities can change overnight, as witnessed by anybody that was paying attention to New York's SAFE Act. They went to sleep. They had 10-round magazine limitations. They woke up. They had 7-round magazine limitations. It was illegal for you to have that mag in your gun. That magazine in your gun that you went to bed and was 100% legal. December 10th, 2019, all my 15-round magazines became illegal for me to possess. On December 10th, I couldn't even throw them in the trash can. I couldn't keep them, and I couldn't throw them away, according to New Jersey state law. My mad minute is about paying attention to what's happening and understanding that we get caught up in these cases and don't get it, that there's a bigger overall problem, and it's called government overreach. The bigger overall problem with the Breonna Taylor case is the war on drugs is bull crap. The war on drugs says that a certain thing you use is illegal because it's dangerous. But the very same government that said marijuana is just as dangerous as heroin, is just as dangerous as meth, is now legal in many of the states across the country. What? Oh, and also alcohol, which causes as many accidents, violent confrontations, death through overuse, death through abuse, death through just the diseases the use itself causes over long term. Alcohol is okay, but all these drugs aren't okay. And marijuana is okay, but not on a federal level, but on a state level, depending on the state you live in. Can you see how that's confusing? Can you see how that's given the government a lot of say over what happens in your life? And this is coming from a guy who's never smoked weed, never done coke, never done any illicit drugs. But I can see where it's a problem, because what if they make alcohol illegal again? What if they make tobacco illegal? Because again, health reasons. I'm just saying, allowing the government to have a bunch of power over you, those laws are enforced by a gun and a badge. So it really goes back to, when do you support your police and when you're about that boogaloo? I say we can avoid the boogaloo by having the laws change, by getting the government out of your life, by getting the government to back off and not trying to run every aspect of your life. Because you're not going to stop death because you banned something. You're not going to stop people from getting high because people have been getting high since the time of the caveman. But man, 1970 was the start of the drug war with a $2 million budget. 2015, the budget for the drug war for the ATF, and the Drug Enforcement Administration, was $2 billion. $2 billion. We have an opioid epidemic that caused the state of Pennsylvania to declare a state of emergency. Does it sound like we're winning this drug war? I'm sorry, but we're losing. We're losing the war, and the police and the government are infringing on, the government is infringing upon your rights, and the police are the agents of the government that are enforcing that infringement. I don't care what your brother-in-law says about he's going to support, the everyman. Because your brother-in-law or your cousin or your nephew or even that one cop you know that gets coffee down where you get coffee is just one person. Most of these people are going to enforce the law because that's their job. And they're not going to give up the pension they've worked a significant portion of their adult life to get, because they'll step on your rights to get it. I'm just saying, they're not going to give that up because of you as an individual. So anyway, I just wanted to point that out. I find it interesting that people somehow are going to back the blue and say, don't tread on me, cold dead hands, I'm ready for the boogaloo. But they're going to be super pro cop. And I'm like, have you figured the dichotomy of that in your head? Like, how does that work? I'm not anti-law enforcement at all, but I'm anti-horrible laws. And there's no reason to put police in the position where they have to enforce something that pretty much takes away your civil right. That's where I stand on the whole thing. That's where I stand on any law. It's at least it's consistent. All right. Well, that was the Mad Minute, and we're going on 10 minutes of it. And it's a question. Look, I'm going to believe what I'm going to believe. You can believe what you want to believe. But can you answer the question? That's all. And how do you feel about it? All right. Be back with Gear Whore. Talk to you in a minute. It's been a stellar month for the Second is for Everyone diversity shoot. We've got some cool companies that decided to come aboard and help us out. And one of those companies is Cold Steel. Cold Steel Knives. Everybody's heard of Cold Steel Knives. They have some of the coolest commercials on the internet. Well, they donated some swag and two of their 1911 knives, folding knives. They're going to be at the diversity shoot being held at the Heritage Guild in Easton, PA. And I can't wait for someone to win those. Thank you, Cold Steel, for stepping up and helping out a Second Amendment grassroots advocacy group like the Second is for Everyone. Check out Cold Steel, see some of the cool products they have, and pick one up because they support us, and you should really support those that support you. Welcome back to Civil War, episode 76 of the 2A4E podcast. And get ready to hear some annoying ambient noise as I play with the gear I'm going to review today. What I'm talking about today is the High Tower Armory 9022 chassis that is for the Ruger 1022 carbine. If you don't know what a chassis system is a replacement for your stock firearm. You take the action and everything, usually you take the action and everything off of your firearm and you put it inside this chassis that replaces the original stock. This particular chassis system, I've been using at diversity shoots. High Tower Armory actually provided it for us. It makes your plain Jane 1022 look like an FN P90 with a suppressor or silencer or whatever. But if you don't know what a FN P90 is, ask your kids because they play video games. They've seen it in all the Call of Duties and almost every first-person shooter that uses realistic firearms. It is a bullpup design, which means the action's behind the trigger. Bullpup design, submachine gun that fires the 5.7 round or the 5.7 millimeter round. And it was developed for the military I think, in Belgium as a weapon that had better range and more power than a handgun, but wasn't so big and bulky as a full-size rifle. And it went to special operations personnel and also personnel that really didn't need a full-time rifle, mechanics, truck drivers, crewmen of vehicles. They don't need a full-size rifle. It falls in line with being something they called a personal defense weapon. Anyway, that's what the 5.7 is, and they have a civilian version of the 5.7, and it's called a PS90, and it has like a 16-inch barrel. It's long enough to not violate, you know, America's laws on how the overall length of a weapon can be, but it's really expensive. I think it's $1,500-$1,700 for the firearm itself, and the ammo has never been cheap because that there were only two firearms that really shot this round. Ruger has just made their own version of a pistol that fires the 5.7 round, and I think that will make the ammo less expensive because more people buy firearms that can fire this round. That's the little history lesson, as small as it is, that gives you some idea what the FN P90 is and the FN PS90 is. Look it up if you want to learn more about it. Lots of videos online about it. But it is a fun, short, overall length gun. And I've put this on this particular Ruger 1022 that was actually donated to the diversity shoot by Les Schaefer of Schaefer Precision Gunworks. So thanks a lot, Les. I took that 1022 that you gave us and I put it in this chassis. And I've taken it to diversity shoots, and I've also taken it to the kids 22 shoots that I've volunteered at, and kids love this thing. And then adults love this thing. It looks like the submachine gun. It's loaded like the submachine gun. It's very balanced. It has a durable polymer stock. This does not feel like a toy. And its overall length is like 26 and a half inches when you use an 18 inch barrel. So it has a Picatinny rail on a top handle and two Picatinny rails, one on each side of the top carrying handle. They're metal, they're aluminum. So they will fit. Anything that will work on a Picatinny rail will fit on this. Yes, I'm moving it around. You can probably hear it in my hands. It's pretty cool. It has charging handles on either side. It's ambidextrous. It has a safety in the front trigger, safe, fire, and you can use it with either hand. It has, you can purchase separately a shell deflector for left-handed people because it ejects shells out of the side because it's still a Ruger 1022 that's inside here, and it ejects shells, but that's where your face would be if you're left-handed, and it has a shell deflector, so it knocks those little 22 shells downward. It still has a safety in a traditional position, cross bolt safety, where your safety is on your normal 1022. It's in the same place here. So you have that safety, manual cross bolt safety. You have the safety in the trigger guard, and you have the safety on the trigger itself, kind of like a Glock that has that little dingus that you have to press to pull the trigger. Same thing on this. The trigger pull is a little stiffer, but you can still shoot it very accurately. I've taken this out to 50 yards. I just have an inexpensive Tasco red dot on the top, and I was able to really get hits. It's really fun. It also has a detachable 50-round magazine. It's a faux magazine, but it holds 22 rounds. I think it can hold almost an entire box of 50. 22 rounds underneath the handle storage container. So it's pretty cool. It accepts your regular Ruger 1022 magazines in the back where a magazine normally goes. But since everything is moved back, it's pretty much under your armpit. It is a fun gun to shoot. Especially with people that either are new to shooting and they don't want the big bang of the AR-15, especially when I'm hosting events inside where you have all the echo, all the AR-15s and other firearms people were firing. New shooters get intimidated. This gives them something fun to shoot. No noticeable recoil whatsoever. And that's great for the new shooter. And veteran shooters walk up. They say it looks really cool. It's very well balanced. It does not feel cheap. Again, because it's made out of polymer and people go, oh, it's going to feel cheap. Nope, this does not feel cheap at all. It has a dummy suppressor on it. Now, a lot of people have an issue with this because it's made of plastic and it turns a little bit. I really haven't had an issue with it at all. And they sell an aluminum faux suppressor, which covers the last, 5 inches of barrel that sticks out the end of the chassis. It covers it and makes it look like a suppressor. Buy the aluminum one if you want. I mean, it's that simple. I don't have a problem with the polymer one. It's a lot of fun. And I'm putting emphasis on fun because it is. You can also plink with this. You can take it out and shoot paper It's pretty accurate. You just have to get used to the trigger pull that is different than your regular 1022. This particular 1022 has a regular stock trigger on it. I have another one that has a BX trigger. Because this uses a linkage system, which is a rod that runs from where the trigger is on the chassis to where the trigger is on your Ruger 1022, you have that distance of about 12 inches or so. Well, not even. not 12 inches. What is this? I don't know, maybe 8 inches. You have to pull that, and it's like levers, fulcrums, that whole thing. Anyway, you can get used to that trigger pull. You can take this hunting if you want. Again, it has a very short overall length. It still takes the 10-round mags. It can also take the BX 15-round mags. It can take the BX 25-round mags from Ruger. I know those work. Aftermarket magazines, they say it could use those too. But even your 10-22 has a problem. Even your stock 10-22 has a problem with some aftermarket magazines. So you'd have to check them out to make sure. If your 10-22 works with that aftermarket mag, it'll work with this. What else? I was able to actually put an Olight on it, Olight Balor, PL2 Balor on it with a laser, because it's just fun and it looks cool and the kids like turning the lights on. Heck, I like turning the light on and shooting at the range just because it's fun. Hunting, I still think you can do it, just you have to figure out the accuracy because it's a bullpup, it changes the trigger pull. Get used to it and you should be cool. Let me see. This is one of the important parts. Fits factory 18.5 inch and 0.92 bull barrels, at least 18 inches in length. Reason being, this thing has to have an overall length of 26.5 inches. And that's what it does, because if it doesn't, you may be in violation. Well, you will be in violation of federal laws. I cannot emphasize how much fun this is. I love taking it out. I love shooting it at the range. The range safety officers always ask the people at the other tables come to you, what are you shooting? It's so cool. Especially in a state like New Jersey where I can't legally have a suppressor, and they look over and it looks like I'm shooting a suppressed submachine gun. It's great. It cost, I think, $230. I saw some sites, I think it was on Brownells, for like $300. Well, I could buy a whole new rifle for $300. Yes, you can. And it still won't look like this. If you're one of those guys that have gone through your, introduction to firearms, and along that journey, I guess you'd call it, you started with a 10-22 and it sits in the back of your safe, putting this chassis on it will make it something you take out all the time. And again, it's something you can easily introduce people to firearms with. It has multiple colors. They have olive drab, which is the one I have. They have flat dark earth, white and black. I think those are the four colors. But you can check out their website, hightowerarmory.com, and see for yourself. They have different things also go on it. They have the ability to couple two 10-round mags with each other, base plate to base plate. And that allows you to reach inside easier and load the magazine in, drop the mag, flip it around, shove it back in, and fire 10 more rounds. I would suggest you get one. Not because they sent it to me, because again, if someone sends me something that sucks, you'll probably never hear about it. And you definitely will not hear me recommend it. I cannot recommend this highly enough. It is so much fun. It turns the fun to an 11. Now, about cleaning your gun, because it's in the chassis system and has lots of screws. A lot of screws holding this together. Let me count them. One too many. It has a lot of screws. And if you want to take your gun out of the chassis system, you're going to have to remove all the screws and try not to lose any. What I found is I can just clean the 10-22 like I always clean my 10-22 with a toothbrush, some Q-tips, and running a cleaner down the barrel and cleaning it out that way with a rod, just a cleaning rod like I always do. Because I have to have my guns work at the diversity shoot, because I don't want someone's first experience to be a firearm that doesn't work. So, yeah, oil it up, I clean it, I take it to the chute. People don't have malfunctions with it. I haven't had any, or at least many that I can remember. Let me see. So I went over the price. Said it has a lot of screws, but the install is quick. I mean, I was able to install it in less than 30 minutes. I mean, I was taking my time. I made sure I laid everything out on a clean table in a room so, you know, screws wouldn't roll off or anything. And I was able to pop this puppy together. It comes with a really well-written, large print instruction manual. So even my old eyes were able to read without a problem. And let me see. So, I think that's everything. I covered the cost, how it's put together. You can put so many accessories on it. Safety has three of them. Storage. Oh, the deflector you can leave off or not even use if you don't want it. Red dots are great. I guess you could put iron sights on it, but the rail is really, it's not long enough to have iron sights and a backup and all that. And calm down, it's 22. That's it, man. So this is the High Tower Armory 9022 chassis for your Ruger 1022. I cannot recommend it enough. Go out and get one. All right. I'll be back with whatever's next. Training concepts. All right. See you shortly. We're on episode 76, Civil War, and we're in the training concepts. Training concepts today is talking about what's happening right now and how do you train in today's environment when it comes to ammo cost, if your range is open, because that's something that's going on in New Jersey now. Our indoor ranges are still at only 25% capacity. The outdoor range I go to, range 14 on Fort Dix, that's where I also teach classes, has gotten to the point you have to book time and have a time slot booked for you to use the range. And they have all kinds of other restrictions. So you can't just pack up and go to the range as readily as you used to be able to. So what do you do? Well, it's something Sean and I used to talk about all the time. There are a lot of things you can do, and let's start off with the least expensive. Which the least expensive thing you can do is dry fire your handgun or dry fire your rifle. Again, I've told you before, you can go to different websites on how to dry fire, different YouTube channels. Just enter dry firing in the YouTube search engine. It'll come up. Go to my friend Ben Branham's page on Instagram. And he spent the entire lockdown showing people how to actually do different dry fire drills with long arms and handguns. Great way to practice for free. If you're worried about breaking your firing pin or something like that, go on Amazon and order yourself some dummy ammo and you can sail right along. I mean, that's something you can do that's $0. A lot of new firearms owners out there, and you may even have a hard time finding ammo to even get your initial foray into firearms started off, okay? Usually I don't suggest people start doing stuff with their firearm if you haven't had a class. And the only reason I'm saying that is this. I don't want you to develop bad habits that you have to spend a lot of time, energy, and maybe even money to break later. But the flip side is, it's better to be at least familiar with your firearm when you go and take your training. So learn some fundamentals, learn how to hold your gun. Maybe I hate guiding people to YouTube videos because you don't know what's good and you don't know what sucks. If you have zero experience in it, because there are a lot of good instruction available for free on YouTube, but it's a bunch of crappy stuff out there too that'll have you doing dumb stuff. So let's just stick to the basics. Load your magazine with dummy ammo. Make sure all your real ammo is out of the room or out of the area. Especially the more experience you have with firearms, the more experience you have with loading your gun with live rounds, you can actually pick it up. You can accidentally pick up a gun, load a mag, and dry fire with live ammo if it's not away from you. Minimize your mistakes. Anyway, dry firing. That's number one. Another one is CIRT pistols, S-I-R-T. CIRT pistols from Next Level Training. I have one. I picked up one in a home defense handgun class, actually, from Marshall Strength Fitness. I think that's the name of Mike's company. Anyway, he sold it to me. It's great. They have pistols. I think they have, I know they have a Glock. They have a Smith & Wesson M&P. I think they have a small, like, Ruger LCP type pistol. And they also have something that you can put into the chamber of your AR-15 and dry fire with that. And when you use it, it fires a laser. So you can see where your round hits. I think you can also use it in conjunction with software on your laptop. I haven't used that one. Software and a camera on your laptop with targets you put on the wall. And it can score your hits and everything else. But that's another way for you to practice getting that trigger time in. Oh, wow. I skipped over another. Well, I don't know. It's about the same price range. Is an airsoft gun. An airsoft gun that looks and feels like your handgun or your rifle. We're talking for good stuff. For something like a Springer pistol, they're very inexpensive, but I don't think their trigger pull is, for the most part, as realistic as your real handgun. I have a Umarex USP that had the same trigger pull as a real USP, and it was crazy. The only thing you don't have, of course, is the recoil because you're shooting an airsoft round. One of the best ways to not have to do a whole bunch of cleanup, though, with an airsoft gun, get a pizza box, put a dish towel inside or a towel inside, tape your target to the pizza box, shoot the pizza box till you're heart content, have the pizza box closed, towel inside, pizza box closed, hang it up, tape it up, hang it, place it, whatever you want to do, put rounds in it, the rounds will penetrate the top of the pizza box, hit the towel, and stop. And that way you're not running around trying to clean airsoft BBs up from all over whatever room you're in. And if you use, what do you call that? CO2 cartridges or something more powerful, you can do that all day. And if it's your gun, you can still, if it's a really good copy of your gun, but an airsoft variety, you can use your holster, you can use your weapon light. It really does make for some decent, realistic first shot training. Also, you can practice your firearm safety, you can practice your draws, you can move through your house with your firearm and have targets in different places if you set them there yourself, or you can have whoever lives in the house set it up. You can make a game out of it. You can score. You can do all kinds of things. I mean, your imagination is the limit. But what you're doing is getting trigger time, sights and triggers. You still get to put that practice in, and you don't spend a lot of money on ammo because that's important. The Mantix X Trainer, it's something that goes on the Picatinny rail of your rifle or your handgun, and it gives feedback to how you pull the trigger, where your sights were when you pull the trigger. It gives a lot of feedback, and it also works on airsoft guns. So you can still get, especially the airsoft guns that are gas-powered with compressed gas, with reciprocating slides, you can get, again, those reps in, and it can point out your flaws and things you need to work on, and you still haven't burned real powder at a range. Let me see. So that's Mantis X Trainer. That's CIRT, dry fire, and airsoft. Those are the ones that I would go with to get a firearm, either your firearm or a firearm that looks like yours and operates like yours, but it's not a real gun. Those are the ways I would go. Other things you can do is, like I do, I have pellet rifle here, and I do 10 yards slow fire with a pellet rifle. It's nothing like any of the real guns I have, but it still sights and triggers. And it's getting that work in of getting your breathing down, doing the fundamentals. Oh, it's not tactical shooting. Tactical shooting is fundamentals fast. That whole dynamic shooting thing is the fundamentals done correctly and done quickly. You are not so advanced as you can't start and work on your fundamentals. Sorry, but you're not there. Don't buy into it. The experts, the people that kick doors in for a living and put rounds on targets on bad guys, practice the fundamentals. If you want to become better, that's how you do it. So take my advice if you want. It will save you a lot of money. And follow some of these steps or follow all of these steps. It can be fun. And then when you will see how much you improve with these practices the next time you go to the range. I'm telling you it's worth it. You won't be sorry. All right. Well, we'll talk to you next time. I think I'm going to move on to gun culture. This is going to be a good one. Kershaw Knives has decided to help the diversity shoot for the rest of the year. So, October 22nd is our next diversity shoot, and in our prize bag are going to be some knives that Kershaw donated to us as prizes. So, it's going to be friggin' awesome. I want you to check out Kershaw's product lineup because they have knives in multiple price points. Support companies that support Second Amendment advocacy. Kershaw is definitely one of those. If you follow me on social media or have listened to my podcast, you see that I've had Kershaw knives in my lineup for years, mainly because of the bang you get for the buck with Kershaw knives. So check out Kershaw, see what they have to offer, give them some of your money, and hey, on social media, shoot them a message saying, hey, thanks for supporting the Second is for Everyone diversity shoot. All right, back to the show. Welcome. We're on to gun culture in episode 76, Civil War. Gun culture, we're going to be talking about Kyle Rittenhouse and the lessons learned. Now, if you don't know who Kyle is, he was painted by the mainstream media as a racist, an active shooter that drove from Illinois to Wisconsin to kill people. Or he was a young patriot that killed commies and fired the first shots of the new American Civil War. If you've made up your mind that he's either one, I won't try to change your mind. That's not my job today. What I want to do is take a step back and look at how firearms owners, firearms enthusiasts, and just good people can learn from Kyle's plight. Here's one of the first lessons. Don't go to stupid places at stupid times with stupid people. As a firearms owner, two of the things you should try should be at the top of your list to do when you have a firearm is de-escalate and avoid conflict. Avoidance is very important. If you keep your head up, you pay attention to what's going on, you can avoid going into areas, again, stupid places at stupid times with stupid people. I'm not saying it's 100% possible because my job as a locksmith takes me to stupid places at stupid times and dealing with stupid people. So I'm not saying it's something you can 100% avoid. So the statement or the information I have is coming directly from Kyle's lawyer's statement and the videos I've seen. I totally understand that his lawyer has an agenda and his job is to make Kyle look as innocent as possible. Got you. But here's the thing. I've watched the videos. I've heard what his lawyer says. And I've listened to what the media says. And a lot of what the media says falls apart completely when I take the other two things in consideration. Because we all know, after watching mostly peaceful protest, as CNN says, that caused over $2 billion in damage all summer long, that the media can't be trusted to tell the truth. So, let's just talk about what Kyle did. And what many gun owners do. All right, Kyle lived near the community. He lived near Kenosha, Wisconsin. He lived in Illinois, less than 20 minutes away. He worked in Kenosha at the swimming pool as a lifeguard. He went to his job that day, even though there'd been a protest in Kenosha that it turned violent and people destroyed property the night before. And he went into work anyway. He had his mom drive him from their home to his job. Again, avoidance if possible. You don't want to get caught up in the silliness. I know the entire city of Kenosha, Wisconsin was not on fire. But there's troubles. You try to avoid it. He went to work. While he was at work, a friend told him about the high school had been tagged and spray painted with graffiti. He volunteered again to go help clean it up. There's video of him doing it. There's photos on social media of him doing it. So again, that whole he came there to kill people was put to just a lie that it was. So he was doing community work. Again, I'm not saying the guy was a bad guy. I'm saying he's doing good stuff, and a lot of firearms owners do good things. Almost everybody that volunteers at my events, a volunteer for multiple things in real life that has nothing to do with a firearm, and that's what Kyle was doing. After that, while he was there scraping paint, somebody approached him and says, the owner of the car dealership that was destroyed the night before has a couple other businesses, and he's looking for volunteers to help him guard those businesses against further damage by the mostly peaceful protesters. We all know a lot of these people were bussed in from different places, and their whole job was to instigate and agitate. Again, Kyle went there. He got a firearm from his friend, a rifle, and he grabbed his medical bag and he went there. While there, he got confronted by some of these protesters, pretty much rioters, and that's when the confrontation started. So, what is there to learn? Here's a couple of things on the run-up. Again, a lot of this can be avoided. Well, Kyle was on the 17. I was 17 years old when I joined the Marine Corps. It's still incumbent upon you to avoid stuff. Believe me, I probably would have done everything Kyle did because I felt I'd be doing the right thing. Everything so far, morally, as far as I'm concerned, was done right. But as an older guy now, as somebody that knows the repercussions of what happens when you bring a firearm into a situation, it becomes an armed confrontation because you have brought the arms. Everyone is not intimidated by you or your firearm. There are people that think differently. Some don't think at all. Some have been shot before. Some have grown up with armed confrontation as being the norm in their lifestyle. And some people just don't believe you will shoot them because that is not something they're accustomed to. And they think that it's bravado. Now, what do you do when the hammer that you have isn't working to intimidate the nail? Now you have to use it. And again, a lot of it could have been avoided. It's not my job to protect someone else's property. No one's paying me to protect someone else's property. But I totally understand wanting to do it because it's the right thing to do. No one should be able to destroy your property and call it a protest. Totally get it. But understand the cost. It's going to cost Kyle a lot of money. It's going to cost him options that he will no longer have available to him because of the actions he took of that night. what police department is going to hire Kyle Rittenhouse? And then take the chance of there's some kind of officer-involved shooting that may be totally legit, or an arrest that may be totally legit. Remember, they labeled this kid a racist, even though he only shot white people. There's a lot to being a firearms owner. And there's a lot of responsibility. And there's a lot of fallout that can be nothing but lies. But that's the story that gets repeated. And that's the story that becomes the truth as far as most Americans know, because it was repeated for 2 weeks straight by almost every major news outlet that somehow you're a racist killer that was looking forward to blowing people away. So regardless of what happens in the future, your name is ruined. Take that in consideration as a firearms owner. Now, let's look at what he did and what went down, as in how he used the firearm. He was chased. We saw the video. Stuff was thrown at him. He was chased by a crowd of people. We discover now that he was also shot at when we saw him running away. We saw the short, bald guy that loves to use the N-word on white people. I don't know his name. I don't even care what the guy's name is. He was chasing down somebody that was armed. He was threatening with physical violence. This kid, Kyle, was running. He had his firearm on a sling. He had his rifle slung up. He had his first aid kit. None of that gear got caught up, but he was moving. He got shot at. He turned around. He shot the immediate threat. He put multiple rounds in him. Dropped the bad guy. Or dropped the attacker, if you want to stay saying that I'm not picking a side, but yeah, screw it, I am. It's my show. He shot the dude that was chasing him and trying to cause him physical harm. He put him down. He even made a phone call while standing near the guy. I don't care. Moving right along. He knew he was in a bad spot because people were saying, get him, there he is, he killed somebody. And he took off. If you're not safe where you've done your self-defense shooting, you have to move on. You have to get out of the danger zone and turn yourself into the police or call the police or get the authorities coming. But you cannot stand there being surrounded by hostiles who are intent on hurting you. He continued running. He was running down the street, panicked, looking. And again, crowds are animals unto themselves. Greg Elephants talks about that. He's a police officer, but he also has an awesome blog. I'm talking to you off the top of my head, so I can't even remember what it is, but please Google it. Grant Cunningham, another firearms instructor and author, talks about Greg's Elephants' work every week. Check that out because it's really, really, really worth watching and reading his stuff. But a crowd is an animal unto itself, and all of a sudden the crowd is chasing him. He falls down. He gets kicked in the face. That person kicked him and continued running. Kyle brings his rifle up. Someone else comes and hits him in the shoulders and was aiming for his head with a skateboard. He put one round through that guy's chest. That person ran off and expired right there in the street with a 5.56 round straight through his torso. A second person came running up to him with a... He had his hands up like, oh, I'm unarmed. Then he pulled a Glock out. Kyle shot the guy through the arm. The guy's arm froze up with the handgun in it. He became not a threat. Then Kyle got up and walked off calmly, much calmer than he was when we saw him in the videos before, running. Now, all of a sudden, the crowd didn't see a victim. They saw someone who will hurt you if you try to hurt him. And he was calm looking. He walked off like he had his stuff together. And all of a sudden they dispersed. They did not want any more Kyle Rittenhouse. Went in with his hands up, his rifle slung in front of him, hands away from it, and attempted to turn himself into the police. After that, that was a cluster that... That's on the police and however they handled their situation. He went home to his home 20 minutes away and turned himself into his local PD. Again, things to be learned. He didn't spray the crowd. He put rounds on target on the bad guys. That's something we can learn as firearms owners. His sling kept his gun on him. He didn't lose control of it. Again, trigger discipline. He was good with that. They weren't random people hit. They were only the people that attacked him. What else? Oh, when it came to the police and trying to turn himself in, again, his slung rifle helps because now his hands aren't on his gun. We often say in the training arena that a sling is like a sling to a rifle is like a holster to a pistol. There you go. The rifle was slung, his hands were off of it, and he still had control of the firearm in case more people tried to attack him. That's what a sling will do. His equipment wasn't the best, but it worked. We joke a lot about good enough, but it was good enough for that situation. It worked. It wasn't a top-of-the-line optic. It wasn't a top-of-the-line rifle. But the manufacturer wouldn't have made a difference in any of that, would it? If it went bang every time. So I'm just trying to think of the different. There's probably other things I'm missing in thinking upon it differently. How he handled himself. But my things that I'm pointing out right now are avoidance is better because this is going to cost him well into the six figures. Maybe even seven. If the George Zimmerman case is any indication, he spent over $1 million in legal fees. He owes over $1 million in legal fees. Avoidance is better. $0 would have been spent if he would have maybe left after cleaning up the paint. You try to avoid situations because the cost can be extreme. That's what we need to do as firearms owners. You need to be a responsible firearms owner, and you have to understand the results of what you may do or may be forced to do are way out of proportion to the good you could have done. Just saying, be careful out there. Understand, because you have a hammer doesn't make everything a nail. But if you don't have any other skills besides how to swing that hammer, if you don't know how to de-escalate, if you can't walk away, if you can't, use verbal judo to de-escalate a situation, you may have to be forced to use the lethal tool that you have. Kyle was asked in an interview before the shooting happened, do you have non-lethal? And he says, no, we don't. That sucks. Hey guys, I know a lot of people want to take sides on everything, but sometimes it's better to chill, take a step back, and learn the lessons of what's happening in front of you and how it applies to your life, and not get caught up in, well, what happened that day? Because much like the Breonna Taylor thing, if you know every thought, everything that actually happened through some superpower, it wouldn't change anything to do with your life. If you had the knowledge of everybody had that day, it wouldn't change your life. So you need to take the lessons from what happened and apply it to your life. All right, we'll be back. Whatever's next, I can't remember because I got caught up in this. Talk to you in a minute. High Point Firearms is back as a supporter of the 2A4E podcast and the work that we do to create advocates and grow the firearms community. High Point fills a niche in the firearms market as entry-level, priced, dependable firearms. They were the first American manufacturer to produce a striker-fired handgun, a polymer striker-fired handgun. They produce the best value in affordable, reliable pistol-caliber carbines. They have 380, 9mm, 45 ACP, 40 Smith & Wesson, and 10mm. And that's just their carbine lineup. Last year, they turned the firearms industry on its ear when they showed the prototype for their new YC9 9mm pistol. I truly believe the YC9 will be a market disruptor at its price point with the features and its ability to take attachments and their accessories as a base pistol along with their lifetime warranty, leaves you in a win-win situation. So try High Point for yourself. A High Point car being will be at every diversity shoot where it's legal this year. So you can come and try one out. Go to their website, highpointfirearms.com, and see what they have to offer. Hi, everyone. I want to talk to you about a contest we're having. I talked about it on episode 94 of Cinemass Podcast with Ursula Williams. On the prior episode, episode 93 of the Cinemass Podcast, we discussed the Bubbles t-shirts or the Tony Simon Says Hi from Planet Lovetron t-shirts that were sold or put together by Aaron Paulette from Pink Pistols and Operation Blazing Sword. And the funds from that are used by her organization and mine to, of course, complete our mission, which is introducing people to firearms in a safe, educational manner. And it's funny because I purchased a t-shirt for myself, my wife, and I sent one to my mom. And as I told on Cinemass Podcast, my mom didn't believe that people would actually pay money for a t-shirt with me on it. I thought it was funny until she was like, yeah, your brother got me a pair of socks with his picture on it too. I'm like, but mom, people were buying this to help fund the Second Amendment work I'm doing. And she just looked at me and smiled like moms do when they know you lying. So Ursula said, hey, why don't we do a contest and have people purchase a t-shirt? They can send you a proof of purchase or a photo of them in your t-shirt, and then you can make a whole collage of the people's photos with your shirt on and send it to your mom. I thought it was funny, and Ursula jumped right on it and contacted Epic Eyewear and Troy Industries, and I know she probably picks up some swag from Skillset. I'm going to throw some knives in and some swag in from my end, so we're going to choose three people that send a screenshot that they've made the purchase and bought one of our t-shirts. You can go to diversityshoot.com, click on a link and go straight there and pick up a shirt or even a picture of you in the tee, which is even better. And I'm going to put it together and send it to my mom. So you have until October 31st, Halloween, to shoot me a pic of you in a Lovetron t-shirt. And we're going to pick three names at random and send you swag. So, three people. I keep saying three people. I don't want to forget. We have three prize packs. We're going to send it. So, also, could you do me a favor and throw Cinemass Podcast into your rotation of podcasts you listen to? It's worth hearing. I'm telling you. Ursula's very entertaining. She's funny. And also, you can check out Skillset Magazine's podcast, too, because Jason and Ben are funny. And they have really cool guests on. Not me. I mean, I was on Cinemass. But anyway, I digress. Hey, guys, if you can buy a tee and support us, great. If you can't, hey, just spread the word about it. I'll be making a video soon and putting that out, too. All right. Talk to you later. Have a good one. Right now, we're on to the shout-outs to the Civil War episode. And right now, I would like to thank and give shout-outs to everyone that's volunteered to help run a diversity shoot. I was going over pictures, looking for some stuff for Throwback Thursday, and realized we've got over 5 years of doing this now. 5 years of doing this. And I'm looking at the pictures and there's some people that volunteered all the time. Some people that have moved on and done other things. And everybody left their fingerprints on the Second is for Everyone diversity shoot. They took their time out and stopped their day to come out and introduce people from every walk of life. Every religion, every sexuality, gender, However you put yourself into whatever category these people welcomed you, brought their firearms, their ammo, and took their time to introduce you to your Second Amendment right. I have no money to pay these people, and I definitely didn't have anything but a thank you to give them when I first started. And people were lined up to do it. And I'd like to thank all of them, everyone that took their time out, just as individuals. I know some organizations help, but those people weren't getting paid to be there. They were doing it out of the goodness of their hearts because they believed in the Second Amendment and the fact that the Second Amendment must grow. And people need to know that this is their right and they need to exercise it. And even if you don't exercise it, you need to be aware of it. Because if you don't use a right, when someone takes it away, you won't miss it. But you never know when you might need that right. I think 2020 should have pretty much shown anyone that's paying attention that you have no idea what could happen in the next month or in the next week. So I'd just like to thank everyone who's always helped out without a thought. Hey, sure, I can be there. I'll be there on Thursday. And they show up and they do work and they have great attitudes. And I just really think it's amazing. Speaking of the diversity shoot, the next diversity shoot is October 22nd, 6 p.m. at the Heritage Guild in Easton, PA. Tickets are on sale at diversityshoot.com. Please go there and click the link. Our next event after that, we have one in November on the 19th, and then we have another one on December 10th. We're doing them every month in PA to make up for the lost time and to help out all those new people in the Pennsylvania, New Jersey area that really want to get to the range and at least learn some basic safety and how a firearm works, and also learn about their rights now that an election is coming up, and I really want to get word out. Hey, listen, come on out. Let's talk about it. I'm not going to tell you what candidate to vote for. That's not my job. But I can point you in the direction of their websites or other information about them and other organizations, but I will never tell you how to vote. Except to say you should vote for your rights. Let me see. So we got the contest, which is the Lovetron contest. Cool. I hope a bunch of you guys enter. People who've already purchased a t-shirt, send me a pic with you in it because I don't have a list of people that bought this stuff. And I'll know you're in. All right. I think that's it. We talked about a lot of stuff this episode. I'll see you or speak to you the next time. And again, I appreciate you taking your time out and listening to the show. Have a good one.